So, you wish to become a gentleman officer, do you? Well, no doubt you've heard that little tune encouraging young men of valor to enlist, for if we go 'tis 1 to 10 that we return all gentlemen and all that such. Well, let me be the first to tell you, sir, that if you desire to attain a commission in the British Army, then you do well to already be of a gentler stock. And some independent wealth certainly wouldn't hurt you either, as if you're ever going to get anywhere in your military career, then odds are you'll be spending quite a few shillings on it. Because you see, the British Army, until 1871, runs off a little something called the purchase system, by which most all men desirous of becoming officers must pay for the privilege. And in this patron-voted video, I'll be explaining exactly how that paid system worked, and what you need to do to become a British officer during the 18th or 19th century. Now, a few years back, whenever I heard that a man had purchased his commission, I had always assumed that it was a sign of corruption within the army, of shady backroom deals where noblemen bribed officials down at Horse Guards to get their kids into commands which they were unqualified for. It fed into the already pervasive, and indeed patently false, stereotype of the cowardly and cruel upper-class twit of an officer bumbling about while the NCOs and men of a lower social class did all the real work in the army. Cough, cough, cough. But this is quite far from the reality. While it was true that during the entirety of the 18th century, and indeed the majority of the 19th century as well, that men could quite literally purchase their post in the army, this system of buying and selling commissions was actually a formal, a legal, even a standardized way for the army to actually keep out the cowardly, the ungentlemanly, and the unqualified. Or at least, that's how it was seen during its time. And now before we get into the specifics of the purchase system, I should specify that it was only ever present in the core of the army, in the infantry, and in the cavalry. It was never required, nor permitted for that fact, to purchase one's post as an officer in the more technical services, such as the Royal Navy, the Royal Artillery, or later on when it was founded, in the Royal Engineers. Indeed, the latter two services actually had educational requirements for joining up as an officer, which was really quite a rarity in the 18th century, although eventually stricter standards were put into place for the army as well, but we'll get to that a little bit later on. First and foremost, it's important to understand that just because you could literally purchase an officer's post, and that there were not initially any sort of educational requirements to become an officer, it doesn't mean that there were no qualifications or conditions that had to be met. And it wasn't exactly a walk in the park either to be able to purchase that commission. You couldn't just walk up to Horse Guards, write a blank check, and then get yourself a regiment to play with on parade. To begin with, a man had to be at least 16 years old to even qualify for a commission. And every man, regardless of his social standing, age, or wealth, always had to start off at the lowest commissioned rank. In the infantry, this means you're starting off as an ensign, and in the cavalry, it means you start off as a cornet. And before the days of formalized officer training programs at military academies like Sandhurst, which incidentally actually finds its origins in the Royal Military College, which was founded in 1801 as part of a growing trend across all of Europe to introduce such formal training programs, a man would need to apply for this commission to the commander-in-chief through the military secretary. Now, this doesn't mean that you'd approach the king or queen just to become an ensign, of course. While the commander-in-chief of the British military is now the monarch, before 1804, the position would be filled by a general or a field marshal or some such. Some of the men who filled this role, and you may have heard of a few of these names, include the likes of General George Monk, John Churchill, the future Duke of Marlborough, Geoffrey Amherst, Sir David Dundas, Arthur Wellesley, the first Duke of Wellington, and of course, Garnet Wolseley, the first Viscount Wolseley. But hold on there, lad. You don't think that you can just approach one of these transcendent heroes with your open wallet and beg for such a humble rank, do you? No, certainly not, sir. You require a patron. A man of good social standing, and I quote, in whose respectability the commander-in-chief feels confidence. And it's only after you are deemed to be of acceptable character and stock that you are finally able to be placed on the register for a commission. And then only when a spot finally opens up for you shall you be permitted to acquire that initial rank. All this is unless, of course, you wish to enter a guards regiment, in which case you'll not be applying to the commander-in-chief at all, but directly to your regiment of choice. So if you want to become a guardsman, you'd best have an uncle or some such in good standing there, because any old noble patron won't be enough to enter those three most elite of good old boys' clubs. And, oh, I should add here as well that if you plan on applying any time after 1849, well, they did decide to add some education requirements then, so you'd better hope that you can pass the army's entrance examinations, and only then might you be put on the waiting list. Don't fret too much, though. It's nowhere near so difficult as the Royal Engineers exam. So no matter where you're going to need strong social connections to get there, and the competition can be quite heavy, with every young gentleman volunteer, which is to say, a gentleman who would enlist in the army as a ranker on the promise of a future commission, jumping at the opportunity to prove themselves in the field, and thusly gain their influential patron, and winning for themselves a free commission. As indeed there were free commissions, which men did not have to pay for in order to acquire. Many, if not most, officers during the course of their career would have received at least one free commission, and they were generally issued as a priority to candidates for their first commissions. This allowed promising young men of valor and merit to enter the officer corps without relying on monetary backing or independent wealth. But ultimately, it was always up to the commander-in-chief whether or not a commission was to be offered free of charge. And generally, after the introduction of military academies throughout the early 19th century, these free commissions were given to those cadets with the highest mark, and those who didn't make the cut went first on the register to purchase their commission. And indeed, from 1862 onwards, all free commissions went to either Sandhurst graduates, current serving NCOs, or pages of honor. So alright, perhaps by some heavenly movement, a blackguard such as yourself has managed to graduate with at least some merit from the academy, find himself a patron of certain worthy standing, and eventually a position did open up for you to take. So congratulations, you've acquired yourself your first commission and free of charge at that. But even if it was freely given, odds are that you've still spent a great deal of money already, or perhaps I ought to say, of other people's money. After all, your uniform won't be paying for itself now, will it? And those years as a gentleman volunteer, or perhaps as a Sandhurst cadet, have probably carried their own debts as well. Well, on the bright side, the new commission that you've been handed has a very real cash value. It's basically a financial asset, almost like a stock or a share in your regiment itself, and it can actually be sold off for quite a tidy sum in addition to the salary which you'll be drawing while you serve, but we'll talk a little bit more about that later on. For now, if you have any hope of advancing with the army, beyond your simple title of ensign or cornet, you're still going to have to invest heavily in yourself. Because in order to acquire a new position in the army, you're going to be selling off your old commission and putting the proceeds towards the greater cost of your promotion. Essentially, in order to move up, you'll have to pay the difference in cost yourself. Although, well, yes, I suppose it is technically possible to advance in rank without ever having to pay for your commission. Because you see, while most free commissions are offered to men just entering the officer corps, there are always other opportunities. For example, if the officer corps was to be expanded for some reason, perhaps a new regiment is being raised or some such, then these new postings would generally be handed out free of charge. And of course, there's always the much darker method of advancement, as if an officer should lose his life, whether by sickness or enemy action, his commission is put up as a non-purchase one. Indeed, war may be a grim and dirty business, but for the officer class, it might also be an immensely profitable one. Because for every battle won or lost, and every bout of disease, a slew of new job postings become available, allowing for those most eager and zealous of officers the opportunity for rapid and cheap advancement. Assuming that they also survive the war, that is. But if you're hoping to have an easy go of things during peacetime, well, don't expect many such opportunities, because if an officer retires or otherwise leaves the service, then his commission is put up as a paid one. So if your lieutenant retires or is promoted himself, and you as a mere ensign want his spot, you'll end up paying the difference between the value of your two commissions. So let's say that you manage, during your career, to actually earn that extra money, and finally your old lieutenant is moving on. Well, just because you're suddenly able to purchase the next rank doesn't mean that you're going to be allowed to do so. And that's because the British Army also relies heavily on a system of seniority. Simply put, those men who have served longer than you have hold greater authority if you're otherwise of the same rank. Because of this, save for in extreme cases such as a court-martial or a scenario where the morale of a regiment is heavily strained, the first right of refusal always goes down in order of seniority. So odds are, if there's another ensign who's also eager for that same job, and whose commission dates even a month earlier than your own, he's going to get it, not you. And there are also minimum seniority requirements to purchase your next rank, so even if the man before you turns down the opportunity, you'd still need to have been in your own position for a certain number of years before you'd be able to accept. You'll need to have been a subaltern, which is to say an ensign, cornet, or lieutenant, for at least 2 years before you can acquire your captaincy, for example. And in order to become a major or greater, you'll need a minimum of 6 years' experience as an officer. And again, if you happen to be applying sometime during the 19th century, then odds are you're also going to have to pass yet another examination to take on your new role, as these were slowly introduced throughout the Victorian era to further professionalize the officer corps. Now, the paid commission market was hardly a free one. Now, officially speaking, there was for every rank a predetermined price set for its commissions, with equal ranks only ever varying in cost between the infantry, the cavalry, the guards, and the horse guards. Now that being said, of course, in practice, this wasn't always the case, as every commission also had an unofficial market value, which fluctuated sometimes dramatically depending on a variety of different factors, such as the overall availability of commissions in the market, the reputation of the regiment to which it belongs, where the regiment was stationed or where it was rumored to be sent, and of course if the nation was at war or at peace. And this true value of a commission to its owner could be anywhere from twice as high as the original set cost, or only half as much, depending again on the conditions surrounding it. So, given the rapidly changing market value of every individual commission, and the possibility to acquire these valuable investment assets cheaply while on campaign, well, perhaps you've decided that you want to try and play the markets a little. Be something of a commission broker, hopping from regiment to regiment, buying and selling your posts as their reputations and conditions go up and down, betting on the performance of individual regiments in the field, and your opportunity to distinguish yourself in their service. It seems like you could earn yourself quite the pretty penny doing that sort of thing if you did it well. So what's the catch? Well, while it was absolutely possible to exchange one's commission with an officer of equal rank in another regiment, which perhaps you feel is of greater value, in doing so, you would also become the most junior man of that rank, losing all of your seniority, and as such, the power, both in opportunity for advancement and in the social structure, which comes along with that seniority. Let's say, for example, Captain Gardner of the 54th Regiment decides for some reason to exchange his commission with a man of equal rank in the 10th Regiment of Foot. Now, Captain Gardner has been in the army for some time and has earned himself many years of seniority with the 54th, giving him certain privileges and authority among the other captains of that regiment who had not been there so long as he. But when he joins the 10th Regiment, he's taking on a new commission. And therefore, even if he's been in the army for many years longer than some of the other captains there, Gardner becomes the least senior captain of his new regiment. So long service with a single regiment was certainly rewarded, and unless it was to escape a bad situation within your old regiment, or to purchase a higher position in a new one, in which case you'd be the most junior man of the new rank anyways, it was generally not a very good idea to hop from regiment to regiment, as it would make further advancement in any regiment nigh on impossible, as you would always have the last right of refusal. And of course, it was also not permitted to exchange commissions in order to avoid active service. So if you hop into the wrong group, hoping to make a quick profit, but then they suddenly have their orders change, and they get shipped out to fight the Spanish in the Caribbean, which, incidentally, for most of history, was not a tropical vacation spot, but a veritable death sentence due to disease, well, you're stuck there. So rather than trying to play the commission market, you'll find that it's far more valuable, both to your reputation and to your finances, to stick with an individual regiment, and only ever change regiments when it's in the name of advancement to your commission. After all, with every gain in rank, you're drawing a greater salary, on top of acquiring greater worth of your commission. And if your commission is given free of charge by any of the means mentioned previously, you gain all of that value without having to pay out a single shilling. As I mentioned earlier, an excellent way to think of the paid commission system is sort of like a stock market within the army. A commission is a financial asset, always changing in value, but constantly providing steady dividends in the form of a salary. And much like a stock in a company, when an officer is ready to retire from the service, he can sell out of the army and pocket the money, providing for himself a tidy little retirement fund or a pension. A commission in the British Army during this time period is effectively an investment in one's own military career. And while it would be dishonorable to do so, there's nothing really preventing a man from selling out right before his regiment is shipped off somewhere unsavory. You just can't swap to another part of the army to avoid active service. You have to fully retire from it. But I can still see it in your eyes. You're trying to think of some way to game this whole system for financial gain without ever having to actually risk life or limb on the field of honor. You're thinking that if you could just get a free commission or two, you can immediately sell out and pocket all of that money, use it to buy yourself an estate somewhere in the colonies, away from the men you've scorned through your cowardice. Well, I can tell you it's not going to work, because if you ever do receive a free commission, you're also required to be under arms for a set number of years before you're allowed to sell it for your own pure profit. If you're an ensign or a cornet, you'll be in the army for 12 years before you can ever sell out. If you're a lieutenant, it's 15 years. And for anything higher than that, you'll need to serve for a full 20 years before you can make off with that little nest egg. And in the end, even with all this talk of financial gain and promotion, of free commissions and salary payments and the like, you must not forget that you are not just buying a simple financial asset. This is an officer's post within the army. It is not for the weak of heart or for those looking to get rich quickly. Because a French or Russian bullet doesn't much care what you paid for your commission, and the bloody flux is indiscriminatory with regard to matters of seniority. And of course, in the harsh life of a gentleman soldier, there is another fate which may await those of cowardly, disobedient, or weak constitutions, and it is in many ways far worse than death. If you, as an officer, prove wholly incapable for the task set before you, and thus unworthy of holding the commission granted to you by your sovereign, you could well be cashiered. For a man to be cashiered is for him to be stripped of rank, often quite literally and before his own men on parade, with aspects of his uniform being torn away and destroyed before him in a shameful and demeaning ceremony. But even worse than the ruin of one's reputation, it also means that your commission is taken from you, and thus you lose your right to sell it. Whether it was free or whether you had to pay out of your own pocket for every promotion you've ever received, in that moment of cashiering, all of the value is lost completely. To be cashiered is to be ruined, socially and financially. And And that about wraps it all up. As you can see, the purchase system in the British Army was hardly the simple matter that many have made it out to be in the past. It didn't just allow anyone with the funding to purchase himself an entire regiment so he could sadistically play with men's lives, but was actually a complicated system involving many conditions which was, in theory at least, specifically designed to weed out the wheat from the chaff and ensure that every man who entered the officer corps was deadly serious about his career and its advancement. Entering the officer corps was hardly just a matter of buying the job, and statements like "he purchased his commission" were hardly the demeaning and snide little insult of salt-of-the-earth men against the posh upper-class twits that so much modern media makes them out to be. Indeed, some of the greatest officers in all of British military history were gentlemen who paid for their position. So I hope for all of you fine young time-traveling gentlemen who intend on becoming a Georgian or Victorian-era British Army officer that you may have found this video helpful in your endeavors. Thank you again to my gracious and ever-patient supporters on Patreon, and of course until the next time, my dear viewer, I am and I shall remain your most humble and obedient of servants.